everybody. Welcome to Old Tales of Nevada, past and present. Glad to have you with us for this week's show. We have a great show in store, talking about Elvis, Marilyn Monroe, space aliens, the history of movies in Nevada, and we'll have it all for you right after this message.
Hi there. I'm here, Roy Marshall of the Marshall Mint in Virginia City, Nevada. I'm proud to announce that our 7-ingot set honoring the V&T Railroad is now finished.
That's right, you, Roy. These beautiful 999 silver ingots celebrate the engines from the world-famous V&T Railroad and honor Nevada's sesquicentennial. These limited edition treasures can be purchased only at the Marshall Mint in Virginia City, Nevada.
Or visit us at marshallmint.com to get yours today.
All of us at Shoeman's Custom Cycle are ready to get you and your Harley ready for the road. From oil and tire changes to high-performance engine upgrades and dyno tuning, we at Shoeman's have got you covered with experienced factory-certified mechanics and a full-service machine shop loaded with parts and accessories. Shoeman's Custom Cycle has been serving northern Nevada since 1988. So ride on down to Shoeman's Custom Cycle at 275 East 4th Street in downtown Reno.
Shoeman's Custom Cycle. We're the biker's bike shop.
Everybody to Old Tales Nevada, past and present. I'm John O'Brien, the host of the show. And with us this week is our substitute for you, Roy Marshall, Larry Elliott. Good to have you with us again, Larry, good friend of the show. And then also our special guest today is Robin Hollibert, and she has a great knowledge about the history of movies in Nevada, and kind of an exciting story. So, Robin, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Glad to have you with us. We've been trying to get you on the show for a long time.
I know. I've been busy writing a book, but
that's
it's
right.
Done.
Writing a book. You host a radio show over there at the KMPR, right?
KUNR, yes.
Oh, KUNR. Uh-huh. What's KMPR?
That's the TV station.
Oh, that's
I
the TV
radio.
Station. Oh, okay.
The voice.
Very good. Very good. Well, great to have you here, and we've known you for a number of years because of your work with the movie industry. And when I was in TV at KOLO, I had a lot of interaction with you, and because of Tammy Cummings and the crew we had over there back
great
in the
crew,
90s.
Yeah,
we had
crew,
a great team there for a long time. But anyway, Robin, welcome to the show, and we're going to get your story and all about the movies in just a moment. But Larry is filling in for you right today, so I put the responsibility to him to tell us why we do the
all
show.
Right.
Let's
Hero
see how smart
in
he
a
is.
Green suit.
Well, the reason we do the show is to make all of the locals and the new locals, by the way, that are most welcome to Nevada.
Yes.
More conscious about the wonderful stuff that's gone on in this great state, and the reason why we moved here to begin with.
Exactly. Yeah. We moved here because it's a great state, and there's great history, whether it's the movies, mining, business of all sorts. We have some great entrepreneurs and great stories to tell. Unlike many other states, we are very special.
We're open.
And the thing is, the history hasn't been as exposed in the state as perhaps it was in Texas, for example. You know, a lot of history about Texas. But so people come here, like you said, newcomers, they really don't know much about Nevada. And once you learn about Nevada, you develop a lot of pride about living in Nevada.
Absolutely. And I came here for 3 years back in the 1970s.
Yeah, and they're still
here. Here I am.
Where did you come from?
I moved from Humboldt County, California, but I grew up in Southern California.
Southern
I knew a little bit about movie people occasionally because we'd bump into them.
Run into them every once in a while,
And I was born on the East Coast, though.
Oh,
so
no kidding.
A bit of traveling.
Yeah, I'm
this
a Brooklyn.
Brooklyn?
Yeah,
Yay.
Brooklyn.
Yeah, that's the hot spot to go now.
It is, actually.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful renovations going on there. But so we take the show and we record history with audio and visual. We're kind of unique that way of all shows being done locally here in Nevada about history. We do audio and visual. And then we have that archived over there at the Nevada Historical Society as well as the UNR Special Collections. So 50 years from now, they can look back at Robin, you, and Larry, and we can
and they can be mystified by the fashions we wear.
Exactly. What was it? So anyway, glad to have you all with us today. And Robin, as we usually do with most of our shows, we like to start with our special guests telling us a little bit about themselves. Like you mentioned, you came here here in 76. Whereabouts back east were you born?
In Natick, Massachusetts.
Oh,
the 10-mile mark on the Boston Marathon.
All right. Very good.
Which I've run six times.
Yeah. So you went, grew up there? And
No. I came here when I was five. I think I went to Disneyland when it had... it was a new park.
New park.
Yeah.
Okay,
a new place to go. Yeah. Yeah. And so I mostly grew up there and went to Humboldt State University in the Redwoods because growing up in Southern California, you don't really know what a tree is.
Yeah.
When I saw Redwoods, I was like, oh my God. So
did
I went
to see
school
the forest through the trees? I mean, those
I
are
did.
Pretty big trees.
Those are big trees, but I still saw it. And then after a few years there, I worked at a TV station there. But you know what? The trees take a whole lot of water, which is rain.
Yeah.
Every day in July. You know how it is working in TV. I'd show up for my shift with this big, thick coat on.
Mm-hmm.
When we came to Nevada, my husband Fred and I, Fred was in mining.
Okay.
And this was a great place to come for that. I figured, sure. We can tolerate 3 years here. And it was very sunny. Mm-hmm. I like the sun. The sun's nice.
Yeah, we haven't had much of that lately around here. But
yeah,
normally.
But I remember it.
Yeah, right.
It's still 300 days a year of sunshine.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
That's what they say. Yeah. I think that's Chamber of Commerce. But anyway, there's a lot of sun.
It works pretty well. Actually, during my years helping movies shoot here, weather was usually pretty cooperative. Mm-hmm. And when it wasn't, the filmmakers found it added extra character to what they were doing.
Sure.
We were doing a Tom Selleck movie at the prison. Uh-huh. It snowed in the morning. Mm-hmm. And they're like, oh, no. And then they went out and shot a scene. Kind of reconfigured the afternoon scene because you know what happened here in Reno. It was all melted.
Yeah, right.
And they said, this is perfect. It makes it look like a lot of time passed.
Yeah, yeah.
He's been here a long time.
Yeah, that's
so
stick
worked.
Around for 10 minutes and the weather changes in Reno, right?
Yeah.
So you came with your husband. 3 years went by. You decided to stay on. And so what kind of work did you take on when you decided to make it a place you wanted to be forever?
Yeah, well, I used that fact that I had a journalism degree. And, of course, the theory operating that it doesn't matter where you move, there will always be a newspaper.
Right. We're kidding about that.
Yeah.
We're not so sure about that anymore.
Disappearing.
Less sure, but I wasn't rushing out to get a job, so I applied at a couple of places where I figured, I don't do broadcast. Well, they hired me right away, so I did some broadcast work before moving into government public relations. I actually went on to UNR at nighttime and earned a master's in public administration, which is the same thing as an MBA, but for government workers.
Okay.
And I did publicity for the Washoe County School System, then moved to the State Highway Department, NDOT. And the interesting thing about that was that it had me go all over the state writing press releases about potholes in different roads. No, I did more than that.
They don't have potholes here, do they?
No. But I got to see so many wonderful corners of the state. And about that time also, economic development realized, hey, she's going all over the places and taking pictures. So I got a phone call. We need some pictures of Wendover. Are you going there? Because I was.
Yeah.
And I said, sure, I'll take these pictures for you.
Okay.
And then when they decided to start a branch of the film office in Reno, they just called and said, oh, we know you love your job with the highways, but would you like to come and promote filming in Nevada?
Wow.
I'm kind of like, highways, movies.
How long? About 30 seconds to make that decision?
It was a pretty fast decision.
Yeah,
so in around 1987, I moved over to the state film office and stayed there for 21 years.
Wow. Congratulations. Yeah. That's great. So they already had something down in Vegas, huh? They already
had Vegas was the place to start. Obviously, Nevada is associated with Las Vegas. There's always been a tradition of filming down in that area.
Yeah.
We have good history here. As a matter of fact, the first film ever here.
Right.
But, yes, it made sense to have it in Las Vegas, which was an easy drive and or flight for production people.
How many miles is that? About 150 miles between the
200
miles?
It's
not very far.
It's a pretty short drive.
Yeah.
And in those days, we had our office at the airport. So you could just hop on a one-hour flight. This is way before 9/11 and all the hassles it is to fly.
Sure.
It was easy to do a meeting in Las Vegas.
Okay.
But then they realized it would be helpful to have somebody up here who really knew the area and could promote what was here.
Yeah.
And as it turned out over the years, sometimes people thought they wanted to do their project in Las Vegas, like Sister Act.
Mm-hmm.
It was written for Las Vegas.
Sure.
But it ended up filming in Reno. It was completely reconfigured. And we weren't head-to-head competing because we're the same agency.
Right.
So we shared our projects. But having somebody up here who knows the area is a helpful point.
Yeah, yeah. And they both have their unique character.
Yes.
You know, some movies just actually, you know, it's better to do it here because of the environment around us. And
we've actually faked a number of Vegas movies. The infamous one, Showgirls.
Yeah.
A lot of Showgirls actually filmed here, not Las Vegas.
Oh, no kidding.
And filmed at what was then the Horizon. Lake Tahoe. And used one of our hospitals and some stage space.
Yeah,
we actually have a lot more.
We also used the Flamingo Hilton downtown for The Cooler, which is on Netflix, I think, it's on Spectrum.
On demand?
On demand.
Yeah.
No kidding.
You got to buy it, though. That way I get my 25 cents.
Yes.
Oh, you still get royalties on that.
Of course I do.
Yeah. Well, you can talk about some of the benefits, why it's part of economic development, is because people get paid to work on movies when they shoot here and television shows.
Sure,
yeah.
So when you went into this office up here as a deputy director for the film office, did you have a lot of interest in Northern Nevada, or were you dragging people up from Vegas to, you know, show them the area and the reasons why they should be here?
Well, I never like to think of it as dragging.
Yeah.
But it was not what you would call a no-brainer job.
Okay.
One of the first projects I worked to get up here was Bonanza, The Next Generation, which was the follow-up to the television show, which you know about.
Yes.
And it was some 2-hour movies.
Okay.
So it should be a no-brainer, right?
Yeah.
Bonanza, Lake Tahoe.
Sure.
Well, the producers wanted to film in Canada. So my first job was working to show that we could make Lake Tahoe an income village, incline village, affordable to film a 2-hour movie here.
Yeah.
And we did.
Oh, you did. Okay.
It took work, and the owners of the ranch at the time, Bill Anderson, you know, really stepped in with the community, but it was it takes a village, everybody coming together to say, we want you, and it can work, and we're not losing money doing this.
Right, right.
We're still benefiting by it. It helps tourism as well. It does a lot. But it took work because otherwise the producers were, well, Canada has trees.
Yeah.
It has water. It has lakes.
Yeah, right.
That'll work.
That's for sure. Well, a good thing you were there. Otherwise, we would have missed a real economic opportunity, like you say.
As it turned out, and two more movies after that as well. So it was a good coup for
us. Did you use the original cabin and everything, too?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
No kidding. Back to the old days there, huh?
Uh-huh.
Well, listen, we got to take a break. But when I come back, what we want to do is talk about the history of movies in Nevada, and that takes us all the way back, as you were mentioning before we get on the air, all the way back into the 1800s, which really shocked me, actually, that we could do something like that way back when. And we'll talk about where and what it was after we hear from a couple of our great sponsors here on Old Tales in Nevada, past and present.
For our cold winter days, jackets and vests are the perfect answer. Faux fur and faux leather are the strong fabrics for this season. Team them with maxi skirts for a beautiful seasonal look. All of this and so much more at Boutique Elegante.
Buy Nevada First Gift Shop and Visitor Center at the Reno Town Mall is the place to buy local Nevada-owned products. There is over 4,000 square feet of unique items to choose from. Art, jewelry, books, music, inventions, clothing, candy, pottery, toys, even Nevada-made wine and more. Why, you can even purchase a gift basket full of Nevada-owned products. Buy Nevada First Gift Shop, located at the Reno Town Mall, 4001 Virginia Street in Reno. Buy local first.
Hi, I'm Paula.
And I'm Dan. We're the producers of the Tanner's Marketplace Antiques and Craft Shows at the Livestock Events Center on Wells Avenue.
I'd also like to tell you about our everyday location. We're at Somewhere in Time on South Virginia Street. We're Antique Antiques, booth number 46.
You'll find paintings by Nevada artists, collectible glass, vintage jewelry, Native American jewelry and baskets, antiques and unusual to unique items.
Find it all at Antique Antiques inside Somewhere in Time at 1313 South Virginia Street.
Come see us!
You have got to come and see our bridal designer collection here at Precision Diamonds. We bought our building, lower the overhead. That means everyday low prices to you. Everything is hand-picked here at Precision Diamonds.
Hi, I'm Chris from Past Time at Somewhere in Time. Are you looking for that one-of-a-kind gift that you can't find in the big department store? I have something for all occasions. Got stuff? Need to know whether or not it has value or how to sell it? We can help with that, too. Come and see me Tuesday or Wednesday at Past Time and Somewhere in Time at 1313 South Virginia Street in Reno. Just ask for Chris.
Welcome back to Old Tales of Nevada, Past and Present. We're talking with Robin Hollibird. And great story we're having with you today about the history of movies in Nevada. In fact, we want to mention your new book.
Yeah.
It's Elvis, Marilyn, and the Space Aliens. I see you come dressed for the occasion.
I came, yes. These are my special book tour socks.
Yeah, very good. So
everybody
how
needs
has that been out? That's a brand new publication, right?
Yeah. I held the first copy of my baby here a week ago.
No kidding, a week ago.
Yeah, it's still kind of gurgling a little.
Gurgling a little bit.
And
there
it has
you go.
A lot of pictures in here, just in case those of you that are a little reading deprived.
I love pictures.
And nice big letters.
Big letters.
I love pictures.
Yes, it works for me.
For you senior citizens, yes.
Yeah, for sure.
I find that, you know, I could have called it the Nevada movie book, and I think people would have felt, oh, Nevada movies, eh. But pop culture icons, and that's the focus of the book. It's not every movie that ever filmed in Nevada. Yeah. It's pop culture icons and their place in Nevada.
Okay.
So if you're an Elvis fan, hey, that's a good book because it's got some interviews with Joe Esposito, who used to be Elvis's part of the Memphis Mafia, and Anne Margaret and George Sidney, who directed Viva Las Vegas, which is Elvis's only fictional movie in Nevada. But we
Viva
are...
Viva Las Vegas, was that it?
Yes,
Viva
that was
Las
it.
Vegas, yeah.
Yes. Are you going to sing it for us?
I do an Elvis impression, baby.
Well, you know, to live in Nevada, that's almost a requirement.
It is.
Everybody has to do it. Listen, before we get too far down the road, I want to mention to people that the first film ever done in Nevada was in the 1800s. Tell us about that.
That was 1897, and not in Las Vegas. What a surprise. Yeah. It was up in Carson City, or for us here in Reno, down in Carson City.
Down in Carson City. That seems very odd that the first film would be done there. Why?
Yeah. Well, because it wasn't a feature film. It was a documentary as such, or a newsreel, but not what you call just a little camera doing a newsreel. It was the Corbett Fitzsimmons fight, which was one of the biggest fights of its time. Okay. Gentleman Jim Corbett, who was the subject of a movie starring Errol Flynn years and years later. It was a huge deal in its time. Mm-hmm. And in 1897, you learned about fights by reading about them in the newspaper. Well, the production company got the idea of using three cameras, which is a big deal, to shoot one
we
event.
We use three cameras today.
Yeah, but these cameras are not 70-millimeter film cameras.
Yeah.
And when I say 70-millimeter, you know you go to a theater and you see 35, if it's not digital, 35-millimeter. We're talking Lawrence of Arabia-size screen.
Which looked like a tank, right?
Yeah, and they filmed this fight, and the three cameras gave them the chance to edit together imagery rather than just show the whole fight straight. It became one of the first blockbusters in the country.
No kidding.
Even though people knew the surprise results of that particular fight, they'd read about it in the paper, they wanted to see it in person. And this movie went to Boston and showed in a theater, and it was a blockbuster, and it would stay in Boston until it ran its course and go to Chicago. It played for 3 years.
No kidding.
As one of the nation's first blockbusters. So very historic film. It's in the National Registry of Films.
It's probably the first time anybody heard about Carson City, Nevada, right?
Well,
in many parts of the country.
Yeah, we did have a mint, so people saw their little coins with CCs. Yeah.
That would be their claim to fame in those days, sure.
Yeah, and you can see a plaque honoring that movie. It's, I was there when we dedicated it, Musser Street near the Sheriff's Department.
Isn't that something?
But yeah, a very significant historical film. 1897, that makes us have a good long history in filmmaking.
Yeah, for sure. I didn't even know they could do that in those days. You know, make a motion picture. It wouldn't be sound, but I didn't even know they could do a motion picture back in those days. And then they also did the fight here, too.
Yes, the Johnson-Jeffries fight in the 1900s. And, of course, that was a huge, the Great White Hope movie story, all of that. Ken Burns has since done a documentary on it that uses some of the footage from that fight. You can find it on YouTube.
Sure, I've seen that.
But yeah, it's tremendously historical. Same type of thing. Early on in history, our movies were more like documentaries or newsreel, but they were shot on film and took editing and the whole motion picture production process.
Yeah, what a lot of people may not know is that the movie industry actually started on the East Coast.
Yes.
Around where I used to live, Fort Lee, New Jersey. Some of the original, what was the movie you mentioned?
The
Great Train Robbery was filmed there. And that Little Rascal, the Rascal Gang.
Little Rascals,
Little Rascals was filmed in Fort Lee, New Jersey.
The Bowery Boys were in New Jersey and probably hit some of that area as well. Yeah. But yeah, The Great Train Robbery is considered the first feature film. By our standards, no, it's 10 minutes. I don't remember how long it is, but it's not very long.
Yeah.
And going through my book, some of the historical titles, we had have a Western link, Las Vegas, Red Rock Canyon, Valley of Fire, and Roy Rogers came several times. He did The Bells of St. Angelo and Hell Dorado.
Wow.
And they're down there as movies, but if you watch them, they're barely over an hour.
Oh, okay. It took a lot to make a movie of any kind.
It was a big deal.
Technology wasn't easy. Editing wasn't easy.
Exactly.
I remember when I worked for my first TV station, we used to shoot a 30-second commercial, right? It was done on 16-millimeter film, and they take it out to a cutting board and sit there with a razor and cut the pieces off and then splice it all together. It took a long time just for a 30 second.
That's how
commercial.
I used to do my newscast.
Yeah, right.
To splice that tape together.
Pretty amazing.
Yeah.
So that was kind of the genesis of movies for Nevada.
Uh-huh.
And were there a lot of movies being made in Nevada along those early parts of the 1900s?
And most people are surprised by the number of titles.
Yeah.
However, no, it doesn't compare to Los Angeles. It doesn't compare to New York, which is still, multi-billion dollar industry in both New York and, of course, Hollywood.
Right.
But we have a surprising number of titles and different types.
Mm-hmm.
The book I did, I break down into genres, but each genre is introduced by an iconic character. So Indiana Jones actually shows up. He didn't really film in the state, but when I talk about the atomic or the nuclear test site, the Nevada test site, there's a scene of him in the last one that's set at the test site. Going back to Giants, because I talk about Giants, the test site.
Right.
Some of the stories
of that show? Giants? There was a bunch of stars in that show.
No, I'm not talking about Giants, that movie. I'm talking about the horror topic of Giants.
Okay.
The amazing atomic man. That kind of giant.
That kind of space aliens.
The effect of those giants. So when I talk about giants, we also have other giant objects or things such as... 1 million B.C., the first version, filmed at Valley of Fire. Yeah, Valley of Fire.
Where's
in Las
located?
Vegas.
Where's that?
It's about an hour north. East of Las Vegas.
Okay.
It's beautiful. It's totally worth going to.
Yeah.
And that's another thing in the book. I list a lot of locations found in these places. And so if you're planning your Nevada road trip, it's something you can stop off at. The truck stop in Fallon. That's where they did some of Joyride.
Really? In Fallon. I never knew that. Did they have a plaque out there, too?
No, we didn't do a plaque for that one. We have, in downtown Reno, there's a plaque for the Misfits over at Harris.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And on the Arch, there's a plaque for Sister Act.
Really?
Yeah.
I did not know
and
that.
And up at Tahoe, there's a plaque for Godfather Part II. So we have a few around town.
Yeah. Well, it'd be great that, it's great to see that stuff,
Yeah.
But I don't know. It's you don't look for it, I guess, when you're going downtown. So you walk right by. I probably have.
Well, you've mentioned that we can surprise people with some of the locations. There's a movie called The Cooler. pretty much.
The cooler, yes. Not at the old Flamingo Hilton, which is now a condo.
It's a condo.
And the reason why they chose it, I'm sure, was because it was an empty casino, but it still had all the machines in it, and they had total access to everything 24 hours a day, and plus they could put the people like myself in the room upstairs. Yeah.
What year was that, Larry?
Oh, that was about nine.
That was in the early 2000s.
2003, but Alec Baldwin got a Best Supporting Actor nomination
really?
At the Oscars, which they just happened to choose my scene.
All right, so it was called The Cooler.
Yes, but what would mystify people is that none of the movie takes place in Reno. It's all Las Vegas.
They have this long establishing shot coming in, like the helicopter of the strip and everything, and then they go right to the casino. And you never think anything.
It doesn't occur to you that you're in different locations.
No.
When they come in and do a big production like a full length movie, I mean, how many people they bring with them? It must be hundreds of people, I suppose.
It can be. It varies. And the reason we were part of economic development was twofold. One, if they hire our locals, that's paychecks around the community, and that money gets spent in the community. And hey, we pay our taxes with those paychecks.
Sure.
Or if they can't find all the people they want up here, they bring a crew up, and the crew stays in a hotel, as you mentioned with the cooler. You know, they paid for those rooms, so we still get room tax.
Yeah.
Yay. Whatever happens, they're going to be spending money. But a typical regular mainstream movie is going to have several hundred people working.
Several hundred people. Isn't that amazing?
From their point of view, though, see, that was the big discussion they had in the last couple of years when they tried to turn the convention center into a small studio, is that you still don't have access to equipment like a dolly and
you have to bring that all in.
Yes, that big list of people you see at the end of the movie, like you have five major stars and then 15 others, and then you've got a list of everybody that the Foley man, all that other stuff.
Sure, all that.
We did one shoot in San Francisco at the gun range out by the lake, for a thing called Midnight Caller.
Mm-hmm.
And it cost them $50,000 for one day shoot out there, and they didn't even use any of the footage.
Isn't that something?
Yeah, and it was all because of the crew and all the equipment.
Yeah, that's where you get into the millions of dollars on these major films.
Exactly. Although the last feature film I worked on 8 years ago or so was Love Ranch, varying off of the Mustang Ranch. They spent about a week here, which they never intended to do. Mm-hmm. They just came here to look at us and say, oh yeah, this is how we can fake Reno and Albuquerque. But they spent a week with us, and the producer told me he estimated they spent about $3 million while they were here. Well, not while they were here, over the whole process of getting that piece of the project
going. Definitely economic
development. So it was economic development. We will sometimes fake Las Vegas very well.
Yeah.
Most people don't realize Showgirls, one of our great claims to infamy.
Yes.
At least 3 or 4 weeks of that filmed up here in Reno.
Okay, we've got to take a break right here. We'll be back with more of Old Tales Nevada, Past and Present. We're going to find out what the heyday was for movies in Nevada. I imagine you got something to say about that in the show or in your book. So we'll be back with that right after this. Somewhere in Time is the place to find what will be treasured for all time. A store full of the unexpected, with one of the largest beer and sports memorabilia collections on the West Coast. Vintage toys, casino and brothel memorabilia, Venton glassware, kerosene lamps from the 1800s, Sun Purple glassware, vintage neon, new and enlarged collections throughout the store. Have fun with the whole family and check out all the inventory in the store. Find the unexpected. That'll be treasured for all time at Somewhere in Time.
Deluxe Travel, locally owned and operating since 1991, is the home for travel to Mexico and Central and South America. The crew at Deluxe Travel is bilingual, trustworthy, thorough, and caring. They will do everything possible to make your dream vacation the best it can be. Now is the time to book for winter travel, so stop by the office at 100 California Avenue or call 686-7000. You can also check us out on our website at deluxetravelltd.com.
At Deluxe Travel, we sell dreams. Come in and plan yours.
Hi, I'm Paula.
And I'm Dan. We're the producers of the Tanner's Marketplace Antiques and Craft Shows at the Livestock Events Center on Wells Avenue.
I'd also like to tell you about our everyday location. We're at Somewhere in Time on South Virginia Street. We're Antique Antiques, booth number 46.
You'll find paintings by Nevada artists, collectible glass, vintage jewelry, Native American jewelry and baskets, antiques and unusual to unique items.
Find it all at Antique Antiques, inside Somewhere in Time at 1313 South Virginia Street.
Come see us!
Hi, I'm Chris from Past Time at Somewhere in Time. Are you looking for that one-of-a-kind gift that you can't find in the big department store? I have something for all occasions. Got stuff? Need to know whether or not it has value or how to sell it? We can help with that too. Come and see me Tuesday or Wednesday at Past Time in Somewhere in Time at 1313 South Virginia Street in Reno. Just ask for Chris.
Here in Old Tales of Nevada, past and present, and let me just reintroduce everybody to you so you know who we are. I'm John O'Brien, the host of the show. Over there where Roy usually sits is Larry Elliott, and our special guest today is Robin Halibert, and she was the former deputy director in the movie office, I guess is the best way to say.
That works.
And up here in Reno, and there was another one down there in
Las Vegas. Still is one in Las Vegas.
So if anybody knows about movies in Nevada, it is you. You are the authority on that. I wanted to ask you, what was the heyday of movie making in Nevada? I seem to think like it's the 60s, but am I wrong on that?
Well, it's a different type of movie made in the 60s. In terms of economy, it was the mid-90s going up to 2000 where we probably brought in the most revenue tracked from projects that we had.
Okay.
And here in Reno, we would have two or three going on in development at various stages at a time.
Okay.
That dropped off after the rest of the country caught on and created incentive programs.
Mm-hmm. Everybody's doing incentives nowadays.
Yeah, and they started providing money to movie companies to go there. I mentioned a couple of projects like Love Ranch, mm-hmm. which was all set in Nevada but mostly filmed in New Mexico because New Mexico helped subsidize that movie.
Yeah, and they gave
had
millions,
money.
Right?
Millions.
Yeah. What are they doing? Tax credits, cash? How does that work?
Combo and loans.
Loans. Okay.
Yeah, that made it more feasible to do. So I was really busy during those times.
Sure.
I was always fielding mm-hmm. different projects. And mm-hmm. I was going off, calling up, and trying to get more projects, but we were having a lot of success with it.
Okay.
It became difficult towards the end because their question is, well, what are you giving me?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I do a really good job as film commissioner. And that didn't seem to be worth $15 million to them. So.
It's all bottom line anymore, isn't it?
Yeah. But
so,
when you say 60s, there were some classic films made in the 60s, both in Reno and Las Vegas, and also television projects. And I include television as production.
Sure.
You know, the 60s had Bonanza. It was the number one show in the country.
For a long time.
Yeah, for over 10 years. Yeah. And although the bulk of it filmed on stage at Paramount, the producers always wanted to shoot some of it up here because it started as a program to market a product,
mm-hmm.
economic development, a product, mm-hmm. color television.
Oh, okay.
And Tom Sarnoff and David Dortort, the creators, felt that the colors, the natural colors of Las Vegas, would highlight this product really well.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, that became the number one show. Every Sunday night in the 60s, what were you going to do?
Watch a Bonanza.
Sit down with the family.
Ed Sullivan, Bonanza.
And every beginning of that show, what did you see?
The Lake Tahoe.
The shot from down incline.
Uh-huh. Down incline,
With a map, burning map that said Reno, Lake Tahoe, Carson
Virginia
City.
Virginia City, and it may look like they were next door neighbors.
Right. I talk about that in my book. I have a theory on that.
But I remember there's that one opening where they're riding up from the lake. That's still there pretty much.
Yeah, that's Tahoe Meadows.
Tahoe Meadows.
In the rebooted series we did, we used Spooner Lake for some of that. But Tahoe Meadows was great.
Yeah.
It was a wonderful calling card for Nevada and kept Nevada in the public's eye for the entire decade.
In the mind, you want to come up here for a vacation to go visit the Ponderosa.
Yeah.
Well, eventually Bill Anderson got that idea.
Yeah.
They had been shooting on his property, and he approached NBC with the idea of, well, what would it take to have you actually do some filming here? So he built the little western town and the Cartwright cabin to NBC specifications.
Wow.
And they were so organized in those days, NBC and the writers and the way TV was done, that they would write 23 episodes. They'd have them all packaged out. Then they'd break them all down and see how much they really wanted to use of Lake Tahoe real locations.
Oh, okay.
They'd come up for 2 or 3 weeks at the end of summer and film the entire season's worth of establishing real Lake Tahoe
B-roll,
shots.
In other words.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, they brought the actors up, too.
Oh, they did. Okay.
Yeah. So we actually got some pretty good filming out of that. And if you watch the, you know, the towards the end of the season, not the first three, but towards the end, you'll see a lot more Nevada. You really will see Nevada in Bonanza.
I saw an episode, and they were up on top of Mount Rose. You know, on that left-hand side is where they have that bald mountain. It's kind of a bald hill or whatever.
Yeah.
And they were chasing some outlaws around.
Oh, yeah.
It was pretty cool.
There
was
always,
also
the famous scene when Little Joe gets the opportunity to bring in a contract for lumber, you know, for Virginia City.
Right, right.
And it's shot on that little plateau that's above the actual Ponderosa site and everything, where the horseback ride and everything.
Oh, okay.
Nice establishing shot where he wins and he's walking across the flat and there's the lake right there.
Oh, isn't that beautiful?
And they never used that area again. I'm real good at
they used on the ranch, as you go above the ranch, there's some rock areas and things. And Warren Green has a shootout in some of that area. I mean, you can really recognize some of the real
Lake Tahoe. Yeah, if you watch it closely, you pick up on it pretty quick.
Yeah, but also during the 60s, Las Vegas, we had Elvis Presley's doing.
Yeah, he was huge in those years, right?
Yeah, and he did Viva Las Vegas down there, which is considered one of his best, if not his best movie. I mean, everybody still sings Viva Las Vegas.
Viva, thank you very much, great career.
It was actually just toward probably early 70s, but Sean Connery came back to do James Bond, and that movie was set in Las Vegas.
Oh, okay.
So while it's not the best of the James Bond movies, it's still considered one of the better ones because it had Sean Connery in it.
Yeah.
Here in Reno, I think the epitome of our filmmaking was The Misfits.
Yes.
And anybody who lived in Reno when The Misfits was filming knew about it. It'd be sort of like having Harrison Ford and Angelina Jolie come here to do a movie.
Yeah,
it was just like huge.
Huge, awesome, yeah.
Yeah.
And they frequented the downtown area. They stayed at the Mapes, I understand, didn't they?
Yes. Yeah. Compared to most movies, The Misfits really spent time here. They shot the movie sequentially.
Mm.
In order from the very first scene to the last scene, like a play, because it was written by Arthur Miller, a playwright. So that meant they had Thelma Ritter at the beginning of the movie.
Uh-huh.
She comes to Reno, does her scenes. Then she's not in for a long time, so she goes back to L.A.
Okay.
And they bring her back towards the end of the movie to do her scene there. It's a very expensive way of filming, but very infused within the community.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's still probably the most significant movie filmed in Reno.
Yeah.
It doesn't show Reno lifestyle as it is today.
Mm-hmm.
The divorce industry doesn't relate to us today.
No.
But there's still wild horses.
Yeah.
And it's
Pyramid Lake.
There's still Pyramid Lake.
That's Pyramid Lake they were filming.
That is
at,
Pyramid
right?
Lake.
Uh-huh.
Misfits Flat. A lot of people think it was up at Black Rock Desert, but actually off of Highway 50 near Stagecoach is a little dirt road and a flat that is now officially called Misfits Flat. That's where
kidding. That's where they did it.
That's
huh?
where the and the courthouse in the very beginning. Kevin McCarthy chases Marilyn up the steps of the courthouse. They're still there.
Now I'm always amazed that there isn't some kind of big plaque at the courthouse steps.
Yeah, there should be in a picture of Marilyn.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, you know.
Well, get that move going.
It's right downtown.
Yeah. So Marilyn Clark Gable, they were both pretty sick, weren't they, at that point?
Actually, it is their last film.
Oh, it's their last film.
But Marilyn just had her usual emotional going
spaced
on.
Spaced out thing. I think that's why they filmed it in sequence, so that she wouldn't get confused.
Maybe.
Yeah. Well, that could be, but Miller may have wanted that as well,
sure.
because
yeah.
of his playwright background. And then another thing going on, she would be late, usually almost every day.
Yeah.
Harry Spencer can tell plenty of stories about
that.
But basically John Huston never much minded because he'd just be at the tables playing till she was ready. Clark Gable did mind.
Mm-hmm.
He was a the consummate pro and he had everything down and he knew exactly what he needed to do.
Right.
And he did not like waiting around.
Yeah.
He found dealing with her to be stressful at times, and so it's considered that shoot was hard on him, especially since he did his own stunt work at the end, being dragged by a horse.
Horse and everything,
And he did not survive very long after the movie.
Well, he had cancer, too, didn't he, at that point?
Yes.
He had a heart problem. It wasn't
cancer. It was a heart problem, and the fact that he smoked a few packs of cigarettes a day
added
to it, but a lot of people feel that the stress of the movie contributed to the fact that
How long did it take to shoot something like that?
That was done over a period of several several months.
Oh, okay.
That's not typical.
No.
Nowadays, they try to shoot a movie in 6 weeks.
Really?
Yeah, if they can. Not every movie can do it, but yeah, they have a very, very tight schedule. So, of course, we have better equipment
Now.
Sure.
Yeah, sure. Technology, editing, everything happens faster.
Yeah, and it depends on the project. It could vary, but we rarely would see a shoot longer than 6 weeks, whereas The Misfits was over a period of the summer. I think that's why you find so many people who have stories about it, because they kept running into the stars.
I know, they'd be eating at the restaurants and at the lounges and like you say, the tables. So that was a big movie. And then after that, I mean, downtown Reno, especially, imagine back in the 50s and 60s when they had all the little casinos still around. Uh-huh. That must have been a great city scene with all that neon and everything. To me, if I was a director, I would love that kind of look, you know, and do a period type of movie.
Well, you know, the one thing I noticed in Sister Act, in her book, is that that when they do an office shot of one of the head honchos calling up to find out what's going on in the casino, it was done in that second floor, third floor area of the new Harold's Club that, you know, it was right across the street from the Fitzgeralds.
Oh, okay, yes, you know, right across the street,
I mean,
sure.
Even though it had been slot machines there, they moved it out and put a table there, and so it was a perfect backdrop for this casino executive, you know, to be calling up and asking, well, what the heck are these nuns doing in my casino and stuff. Yeah.
Now, when they do a movie in Reno, and most of it's shot here and everything, do they do the premieres here, or do they save that and take it down to Hollywood?
It all depends. Yeah. And we've had a mix. Downhill Racer filmed at Tahoe, not Reno, but a premiere was done in Reno. Uh-huh. Virginia City, never filmed in Virginia City, but the governor was really into it and brought all these Warner Brothers stars up to Reno for a premiere. So you see a premiere picture that has the stars, Errol Flynn and others, and Ronald Reagan, who wasn't in the movie, but they had the Warner stable of stars up here for a premiere of a movie that didn't feel
Yeah, so we got some extra exposure that way. That's
generally
good,
now most movies are rolled out in a bigger city, so you might see a premiere in Las Vegas, but Reno's a little small for an official rollout.
Right.
They might do a press screening, a special press promotional event here. We did that with Clint Eastwood and Pink Cadillac.
Oh.
He came out to reveal it to the movie reviewers and that type of group, and you know, he did a special show at Harrah's with Bernadette Peters and threw a party. We had Kix, the Paul Revere Club.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, great. Well, let's take another break. We'll come back for our last segment here on Old Tales in Nevada. We'll talk about what the future looks like for movie making in Nevada and about your book, where we can get it, and that sort of thing. So we'll be back right after this.
All of us at Shoeman's Custom Cycle are ready to get you and your Harley ready for the road. From oil and tire changes to high-performance engine upgrades and dyno tuning, we at Shoeman's have got you covered with experienced factory-certified mechanics and a full-service machine shop loaded with parts and accessories. Shoeman's Custom Cycle has been serving Northern Nevada since 1988. So ride on down to Shoeman's Custom Cycle at 275 East 4th Street in downtown Reno.
Shoeman's Custom Cycle. We're the biker's bike shop.
Somewhere in Time is the place to find what will be treasured for all time. A store full of the unexpected, with one of the largest beer and sports memorabilia collections on the West Coast. Vintage toys, casino and brothel memorabilia, Venton glassware, kerosene lamps from the 1800s, Sun Purple glassware, vintage neon, new and enlarged collections throughout the store. Have fun with the whole family and check out all the inventory in the store. Find the unexpected. That'll be treasured for all time at Somewhere in Time.
Deluxe Travel, locally owned and operating since 1991, is a home for travel to Mexico and Central and South America. The crew at Deluxe Travel is bilingual, trustworthy, thorough, and caring. They will do everything possible to make your dream vacation the best it can be. Now is the time to book for winter travel, so stop by the office at 100 California Avenue or call 686-7000. You can also check us out on our website at deluxetravelltd.com.
At Deluxe Travel, we sell dreams. Come in and plan yours.
Buy Nevada First Gift Shop and Visitor Center at the Reno Town Mall is the place to buy local Nevada-owned products. There is over 4,000 square feet of unique items to choose from. Art, jewelry, books, music, inventions, clothing, candy, pottery, toys, even Nevada-made wine and more. Why, you can even purchase a gift basket full of Nevada-owned products. Buy Nevada First Gift Shop, located at the Reno Town Mall, 4001 Virginia Street in Reno. Buy local first.
Hi, I'm Paula.
And I'm Dan. We're the producers of the Tanner's Marketplace Antiques and Craft Shows at the Livestock Event Center on Wells Avenue.
I'd also like to tell you about our everyday location. We're at Somewhere in Time on South Virginia Street. We're Antique Antiques, booth number 46.
You'll find paintings by Nevada artists, collectible glass, vintage jewelry, Native American jewelry and baskets, antiques and unusual to unique items.
Find it all at Antique Antiques inside Somewhere in Time at 1313 South Virginia Street.
Come see us.
Hi there, I'm Leroy Marshall of the Marshall Mint in Virginia City, Nevada. I'm proud to announce that our 7-ingot set honoring the V&T Railroad is now finished.
That's right, Uroy. These beautiful 999 silver ingots celebrate the engines from the world-famous V&T Railroad and honor Nevada's sesquicentennial. These limited edition treasures can be purchased only at the Marshall Mint in Virginia City, Nevada.
Or visit us at marshallmint.com to get yours today.
You have got to come and see our bridal designer collection here at Precision Diamonds. We bought our building, lower the overhead. That means everyday low prices to you. Everything is hand-picked here at Precision Diamonds.
Welcome back to Old Tales of Nevada, past and present. We're down to our last segment here with Robin Hollaberg, who was formerly the deputy director for the Nevada Film Office.
That's what we called ourselves.
That's what you call it. Is there still an office?
Yeah, we still call it the Nevada Film Office,
but it's
in Las Vegas.
Oh, they disbanded us up here, huh?
Yeah, you know, there was an economic crash and a lot of attrition in government.
And Robin's written a book about her exploits with the film industry over how many years?
21.
Years? 21 years, wow.
Well, my 21 years, but the Nevada history goes back, as we said, to 1897, and I cover some of those movies that I wasn't around to work on.
Yeah, well, he might have been.
Yeah, I think
so. As a tyke. Yeah. We were just a tyke.
John took me by the hand, and I was two at the time.
There you go. So you did that for 21 years, and then you moved off to other things, but do you have a lot of interaction with the stars?
At times. It depends on a project.
Yeah.
And the last one I worked on, Love Ranch, the director, Taylor Hackford, who has since become head of the Directors Guild, he was very open to all kinds of input. And he was researching the brothels in this area. That was the subject.
That's a nice avenue of research, I guess.
Yeah, it was really pretty interesting. You know, we had been emailing.
The personal touch.
Yeah, we'd been emailing a lot of information about it. And then he decided to come take a first-hand look with his production designer. They had to know what sets they were going to build.
Okay.
And so he asked if I would arrange the tour, and when I'm driving them to the different ones, he said, and please sit with us and ask questions.
Oh, nice.
Because getting somebody else's vantage can help with that.
Sure.
So I could have input there, which was entertaining. I hadn't really been to all that many brothels before.
I guess not.
And so. Because he had just directed the movie Ray and had an Oscar nomination for that, all the brothel management was very helpful, you know, because, hey, you got this, he's an Oscar winner himself, you've got somebody interested in your property, let's show it. So a lot of support from that angle. In Sister Act, another scene that shot at Harold's Club was from the basement, and they dressed that as the counting room.
Oh.
And just as a joke when we're looking through, because they hadn't really worked the script, it was written for Atlantic City, not Reno. And there's a grate that went into the sidewalk.
Uh-huh.
And very jokingly, I said, oh, yeah, and Whoopi Goldberg can push the grate up and get out and run over to Amtrak and catch the train to San Francisco.
I remember that scene.
Well, she doesn't go onto the train, but yeah, you know what? They built a styrofoam grate.
No kidding.
And she pushes it up and runs out. Yeah.
Wow.
That's how she
escapes. So do you have any interaction like with Whoopi? I mean, or were the stars pretty much...
I went to her birthday party and said hello.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't hang out like chums or anything, it's special to do that.
Yeah. Do you ever get close with any of them where you maintain a contact?
There are some, not many, but
because
it's a busy thing. But you know, here and there it happens, and that's enjoyable.
Yeah.
It depends on the star. Some are more reclusive. Some want to stay in character the whole time.
Yeah.
Tommy Lee Jones playing the meanest man in baseball is probably not a good idea.
Yeah, right.
Alec Baldwin's like that. He never returns my phone calls or my emails. Never.
Oh, that's such a shame.
I know.
And you worked together, too.
We did work together, and my ex-wife said that he owed me a dozen roses for, you know...
For that scene.
Yeah, for that scene.
Yeah.
He
did.
Okay.
Never happened.
Very good. So what do you think? Now you don't have the incentives for bringing movies to Nevada. So what's the state of affairs now? I mean, are you seeing any production in Nevada now, or is it...
Nevada has production because Las Vegas by itself is an icon. In the book, I have a chapter on Las Vegas.
Uh-huh.
It draws people.
Sure.
And it actually draws an impressive amount. The Nevada Film Office does good track work, and they show that $100 million in revenue.
Not bad.
Without having to push Las Vegas that hard on people. People are interested in coming here.
Right.
The difference is you went back to the heyday when, say, Vegas filmed.
Yeah.
And Robert Urich and the whole production team lived in Las Vegas, and they shot that whole series in Las Vegas.
Oh, okay.
CSI, in contrast, would come every 3 months and do maybe one episode with a lot of Las Vegas locations, and then they'd run around, they didn't run on the blimp, but they would do their establishing Vegas shots to factor in other episodes.
Right.
So you never saw as much... Well, you probably saw more money just because of inflation and such, but you didn't see the same kind of integrated activity within the community that you did in the 60s when they would do that filming.
So now, as I remember, when Tesla was coming to town, that they stripped the movie or the film office of its budget.
Well, not the budget, just an incentive approach. The film office still has a budget. The reason we don't have a Reno office anymore, about a year after I left, they still had somebody here. But with the cuts that were going on, every department had to drop somebody. Well, the person who had come here to work for a year left, and rather than fire somebody in Las Vegas, they just never filled the job here.
Never filled the job here. So you are the authority, unofficial, though. You're the go-to gal.
They still take my calls over at the Nevada Film. And I still get calls from people who think that I'm still working, and I have the same phone number I had then. And so one guy's starting to order me around. I'd given him some good information. He did an ad up at Tahoe, and he's starting to order me and tell me some other things I could do, and I'm like, you know, I retired 8 years ago. He was like, oh, I'm so sorry.
Who do I call?
But I still gave him the information he needed because, you know, we want to see
film. Don't
you
host some film festivals and things like that?
There's one that's in the development process now. I'm not part of that. We had a Reno Film Festival for about 10 years.
Yeah.
And then, yes, I work with the presentation of the Oscar-nominated shorts in town and the Manhattan shorts.
Okay.
And we have a great response to those. People love watching these innovative new little movies.
Yeah, yeah.
They're short, but you still spend 2 hours watching a half dozen shorts.
It would be kind of cool, I think, if you had a film festival with the big movies that were made in the past. You were talking about, like, The Shootist was even filmed here.
Yeah, actually, with some of the Reno Film Festival, the first year we had The Misfits with Kevin McCarthy from the courtyard, you know, the court step scene. We had Rod Steiger come in for a movie he did here, a remake of Body and Soul.
Oh, okay.
We had Tony Curtis come in.
Yeah.
You know, people who have done movies here, and Elliot Gould came and introduced, what did he do here? California Split.
Okay.
And so, you know, that's a fun thing to be able to do.
Sure.
Gives it a little extra. Yeah. But yeah, The Shootist, at one point, we could have brought Lauren Bacall back, and I worked with her on a movie called Diamonds.
Oh, okay.
And Ron Howard's still around. Maybe we can talk him up, you know, talk him into coming up. John Wayne, of course, that was his last movie. But The Shootist shot in Carson City.
Wow.
There's
a
plaque honoring it at 500 Mountain Street.
Mountain Street, where
and
we're at.
Well, it's near the governor's mansion.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And if you look in the window of the house, they have a cutout of John Wayne.
They do. Okay.
So they do know that people care about the movie.
Yeah.
It was his last movie in 1976, I'm saying, about that year. Could be 77 that it came out.
Yeah.
And at the time, it got... Oh, it's so old-fashioned kinds of reviews. You know, we're talking the 70s and revisionist westerns, influenced by The Wild Bunch and Blood and Guts and all of that. And The Shootist was not that.
No, it went the other way. It was Audrey Hepburn was in that movie, right?
No, that's Lauren Bacall.
Oh, Lauren Bacall. Okay.
Yeah, and Ron Howard plays her son. And then there were cameos by Jimmy Stewart and other people.
Wow.
But in the ensuing years... it was a nice final film for John Wayne.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's grown a whole lot more fans. People love that movie.
Yeah, you see it on...
It was a fine farewell film.
Yeah.
I always wish Carson had that trolley that he rides
yeah.
in the movie.
Yeah.
You know, even if it just went across the lawn in front of the house. I got one quick question. In that scene in The Misfits, when they've decided to go to the rodeo and they're in a small bar and
the Odeon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was that in Dayton?
Yes.
Okay.
You know
yeah.
where it's at?
No, I don't know where it
was. It's the Odeon, which is closed.
Okay.
Yeah. So they will open it for special events. They'll have mystery dinners, things.
Okay.
For many years, it was an active bar, and that's where she does the ping pong paddle scene.
Oh, okay.
But the, yeah. the restaurant closed a number of years ago and has never fully reopened.
Uh-huh.
But you can go see the outside of the building. It's wow. got all that character. The main street of Dayton is also in The Misfits, the
yeah.
old main street.
Wow.
And then they go across to a rodeo ground that used to exist in Dayton,
yeah.
but doesn't anymore.
Well, that's pretty
yeah.
amazing, isn't it? You know,
yeah.
When you
yeah.
think about what happened in some of these
and
towns.
And that's over 50 years ago, so there's remnants
yeah.
of it. That's,
remnants, yeah.
It's fun.
Yeah. That's Nevada, though. I mean,
yeah.
we have history everywhere, it seems like.
We
you
do.
Know?
And,
whether it's mining or, you know, movies or who knows.
You I mean, could stop just... off in little towns and suddenly discover you're on what was once a movie set.
Yeah, movie
yeah.
set or something important happened there almost
yeah.
everywhere you go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It really changes your perspective when you have knowledge of history, whether it be about the movies or mining or, you know, different events that happen in town. You just never go by that corner or by that location and dismiss it.
Right.
It brings back, you know, all of that ambiance and you know, just your imagination kind of runs away with you, isn't it?
Uh-huh.
You find that too?
Oh, absolutely. Whenever I travel anywhere in the world, I love to travel.
Yeah.
I usually watch a few movies that were filmed there. Now,
yeah.
I realize movies and reality.
yeah.
But it's fun to get an idea of what it looks like,
yeah.
how it can be used,
sure.
how photogenic it is.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
this year, you know, I was going to Greece and I watched a bunch of movies filmed in Santorini. It's fun.
Yeah. 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 yeah.
It's,
so when you
it's
go
a hoot.
There, you
yeah.
know, you have. You just feel closer to the place,
mm-hmm.
you know, and that's what we try to accomplish with the show is to let people know, hey, on this street corner,
yeah.
There was the Johnson fight, or
right.
down in Carson City on Musser Street, there was this film, you know.
In the appendices in my book, do that for Reno, for Las Vegas. They list all the casinos in Vegas. Vegas, you don't have to do as much of a tour. You just look at the Bellagio and say, oh, yeah, I remember what
yeah.
film there, or, you know, the restaurant and casino, or various
right,
things like
right,
that.
Right.
Reno is a little more detailed as a walking tour, because I often conduct a walking tour
oh, cool.
of movie locations of
oh,
Reno.
Neat, neat.
And then I have a something called Joyride, and it's this fantasy tour. If you start, I think I started us in Vegas, but just drove all around the
yeah.
state on our highways and came back down.
What an experience that would be, yeah.
I've done it, but not all at once.
yeah.
People forget, we're
Robin,
the seventh largest state.
Before we close, where do we get the book?
The book is available at Sundance.
Okay.
And online, Amazon.
Online, Amazon.com.
Yeah.
And price is?
It's $24.95.
And Sundance on California Street.
Yeah,
yes.
It's that beautiful
yes.
white building that
uh-huh.
has great history
Your hands
in itself.
On the way, John.
Yeah.
yeah.
And, you know, the UN student store had 5 copies, but I understand they sold out.
Oh, super.
Yay!
Yay.
Yay.
Yay. All right.
Well, Robin, thanks so much
Second
for being
printing.
With us today. We appreciate it very much. And we just hit the tip of the iceberg. If you really want to get into Elvis, Marilyn, and the space aliens and all of that culture, read the book. It's a,
Absolutely.
It's a I heard some of the reviews are great on it already, so super duper. And, Larry, thanks for filling in for us, for you, Roy. You did
thanks
an
for
excellent
working the
job.
Movies here.
My pleasure, Robin. And you didn't come to the last party we had, and you're going to have a 250 episode
right.
anniversary party.
Yeah, we're coming along on that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So.
Great, and I'm
you
done writing
come.
My book. I can
there
come.
There you go.
Okay.
So, Larry, thank you so much. Robin, thank you, and we want to thank the audience as well for being with us this week on Old Tales of Nevada. I invite you back next week for another great episode, and have a great Nevada day. We'll see you next week.
And happy trails.